Good morning again. Our sermon today is entitled Respect for God's Character. And many times we think about respect, we think about, God, of course, ultimately as do our greatest respect. But we thought about what it means to respect His character. And that's what we want to talk about a little bit today. But I want to advance to our next slide. I want to talk to you first for a minute about Samuel Finley Breese. He was born April 27, 1791. He lived April the 2nd, 1872. So he lived quite a long, prosperous life through quite a transitional period in this country. And he became a painter. He was a very good painter. In fact, he was a portrait painter especially. He painted, for instance, the portrait of John Adams. Maybe you've seen this picture of President John Adams, our second president. He did his own self-portrait. You may not recognize his self-portrait, but he did himself. In fact, in 1825, the city of New York commissioned him to paint a portrait. They wanted to do a picture of Lafayette. And so Lafayette was visiting Washington, D.C. at that time. But before Samuel began to paint Lafayette's picture, in fact, 7 years before, he had married Lucretta Pickering Walker on September the 29th of 1818. And in the time that they had been married, she had given him 3 children. In fact, she had just born their 3rd child as he was painting Lafayette's picture. Marquise de Lafayette. That's what I wanted to say earlier. Marquise de Lafayette. But while painting, a messenger on horseback delivered a letter from his father, and the letter simply read, "Your dear wife is convalescent." Now, what would that mean? She's sick. She's sick. And the next day, he received another letter from his father detailing his wife's sudden death. Samuel left painting Lafayette, and he immediately returned to New Haven, where he lived at that time. And he was brokenhearted. His wife had already been buried by the time he arrived. And for days, he realized that he had been unaware of her failing health, unaware of her death, and he decided to explore a means of rapid long-distance communication so that this need not happen again. And so Samuel Finley Breese Morris, invented what we call the telegraph and a system of dots and dashes whereby messages could be sent. We know it as Morse code today. But what's interesting is that the very first message that Samuel Morse sent with his telegraph was, "What hath God wrought? What hath God wrought?" By this simple act, Morse showed respect and honor to God and His character as a benevolent individual. Beloved, I believe that God's revelation of Himself calls for deference, for honor, and a response to right living. Because we are to respect His holy name. Now, this week, some of you who have been around me, I've been speaking about the Psalms. I've been reading through the Psalms again, and I came to Psalm 29 in my Bible. I'd like for you to turn to Psalm 29 in your Bible, too. And there's a verse here that is so beautiful. I'd encourage you all to read the book of Psalms again. It's a really good book. And I especially like the 29th Psalm now more than I've ever appreciated it before. This is the Psalm of the Thunderstorm. Sometimes it's been called the Psalm of the 7 Thunders. And tradition says it was sung on the last day of the Feast of the Tabernacles in the Second Temple after the temple worship was restored when the exiles came back. But I want you to notice verse 2. It says, "Give unto the Lord the glory due unto His name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness." There is a glory that is due to the name of God. But friends, it's not just simply talking about the name, something that we enunciate. It's speaking about the character of God. We need to give glory to the character of God. You know, in the commandments, in Exodus chapter 20, verse 7, it says that we are not to take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. And we realize that this means that we're literally not to use His name in a flippant or a casual way. But I think it also means, friends, that we are not to deface the character of God by our actions and through the things that we do. We are to honor God's name. And we can't do that, friends, when we are serving false gods. False gods that teach us something incorrect about the character of God, or teach us something antithesis to the character of God. Notice an example in Leviticus 18, for instance. Leviticus 18:21. It says, "Thou shalt not let any of thy seed pass through the fire to Moloch, neither shalt thou profane the name of thy God. I am the Lord." In fact, this reference we just read can also be translated this way. Leviticus 18:21 in the ESV says, "You shall not give any of your children to offer them to Moloch and so profane the name of your God. I am the Lord." Because as you read it in the King James, it says, "Neither shalt thou profane the name." It's almost like it could be two different things, but according to the Hebrew, really it's connected together. It's connected together. This concept of offering your children to Moloch is connected to profaning the name of the Lord. Now, did you notice it said that they weren't to let their children pass the fire to Moloch? Because by doing this, they would profane the name of the Lord. They would profane His character. Because God wasn't like this god Moloch. And many times the children of Israel, they would intermingle the worship of Moloch and the worship of Baal with the worship of Jehovah. And it became confusing to people. And people thought they were worshiping Jehovah, and yet they were following the services of worshiping Moloch or Baal. And we see this today, friends. We see this today in the Christian's experience, in the professed Christian world's experience. There is a teaching that denies that Jesus is the Son of God. And by doing that, it denies that God is the Father of Jesus Christ. And by doing that, it also denies, friends, the verity of John chapter 3, verse 16. That there is a God who loved us so much that He gave His only begotten Son. But of course, if God has no Son, how do we prove His love? The writer John, in his first epistle in fourth chapter, he says that herein is the love of God manifested by the fact that God gave His only begotten Son. And so we don't want to take God's name in vain through the teaching of false things about His character. Let's turn to Leviticus 22. Leviticus 22 and verse 31. "Therefore shall ye keep my commandments and do them. I am the Lord. Neither shall ye profane my holy name, but I will be hallowed among the children of Israel. I am the Lord which hallow you, that brought you out of the land of Egypt to be your God. I am the Lord." And now notice the connector between verses 31 and 32 is that word "neither" again. But you know, sometimes in English that can set off different things. But if we again look at another translation in our next verse, it says, "So shall you keep my commandments and do them. I am the Lord, and you shall not profane my holy name, that I may be sanctified among the people of Israel." And so this is really a connected thought. That when we are walking in disobedience, friends, we are profaning the name, the character of God. As I mentioned in our synopsis, that God's revelation of Himself calls for deference and honor and a response of right living. Because, friends, God's Word always calls for a response. It calls for action in our lives. Going on to our next slide, we have a statement here. This is a little long statement, but I want to share it with you. It's from Thoughts on the Mount of Blessing. And it says this: "To hallow the name of the Lord requires that the words in which we speak of the Supreme Being be uttered with reverence. Holy and reverent is His name." Psalms 111, verse 9. "We are never in any manner to treat lightly the titles or appellations of the Deity. In prayer we enter the audience chamber of the Most High, and we should come before Him with holy awe. The angels veil their faces in His presence. The cherubim and the bright and holy seraphim approach His throne with solemn reverence. How much more should we, finite, sinful beings, come in a reverent manner before the Lord, our Maker?" But to hallow the name of the Lord means much more than this. We may, like the Jews in Christ's day, manifest the greatest outward reverence for God and yet profane His name continually. See, it's not just by the things we say. "The name of the Lord is merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin." Exodus 34, 5-7. "Of the church of Christ, it is written, this is the name wherein he shall be called, the Lord our righteousness, Jeremiah 33:16. This name is put upon every follower of Christ. It is the heritage of the child of God. The family are called after the Father. The prophet Jeremiah, in the time of Israel's sore distress and tribulation, prayed, we are called by thy name, leave us not, Jeremiah 14:9. This name is hallowed by the angels of heaven, by the inhabitants of unfallen worlds. When you pray, hallowed be thy name, you ask that it may be hallowed in this world, hallowed in you. God has acknowledged you before men and angels as his children. Pray that you may do no dishonor to the worthy name by which ye are called, James 2:7. God sends you into the world as his representative. In every act of life, you are to make manifest the name of God. This petition calls upon you to possess his character. You cannot hallow his name. You cannot represent him to the world unless in life and character you represent the very life and character of God. This you can only do through the acceptance of the grace and righteousness of Christ. Thy kingdom come, Matthew 6:10. Thoughts from the Mount of Blessings, pages 106 and 107. Now notice in the last part of this quotation that we read from, in this last slide, it says, this petition calls upon you to possess his character. His character. And we're talking at Camp Meeting about perfection of character soon to come. But what that means is that we have the character of God. Perfection of human character means to obtain the character of God. And friends, we are to show respect to the character of God. We are to show respect to God's very presence. When we come into this sanctuary, for example, do we come in here in a way different than we come into other rooms, into other buildings? Do we talk differently here? Do we act differently? And if we don't, then one of two things is either wrong. Either the presence of God is not here, friends, or we don't recognize the presence of God. Because when people recognize the presence of God, friends, they act differently. Did you notice that? Anywhere you read in the Bible where there's some kind of a theophany, or a manifestation of God's presence, people act differently. And God commands them to. Turn with me to Exodus chapter 3. Exodus chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. This is the story of Moses at the burning bush. And he said, draw not nigh thither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the ground whereon thou standest is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. Friends, in the very presence of God, there is a holy awe. When Isaiah in vision saw the Lord of hosts, he says, I am undone. I am as a man of unclean lips. In Exodus chapter 20, we have the Ten Commandments. But notice what we have also in verses 18 through 22. Exodus 18 through 22. It says, and all the people saw the thunderings and the lightnings and the noise of the trumpet and the mountain smoking. And when the people saw it, they removed and stood afar off. And they said unto Moses, speak thou with us, and we will hear. But let not God speak with us, lest we die. And Moses said unto the people, fear not, for God has come to prove you, and that his fear may be before your faces, that ye sin not. And the people stood afar off. And Moses drew near into the thick darkness where God was. And the Lord said unto Moses, thus shall ye say unto the children of Israel, ye have seen what I have talked with you from heaven. And these people, when God came from heaven to talk to them, were afraid. And they backed off. They weren't ready for that majesty of God. And Moses was learning. Moses was experiencing the character of God to where he could approach God now. In the book, The Spirit of Prophecy, Volume 1, on page 237, we read these words. The majestic presence of God at Sinai and the commotions in the earth occasioned by his presence, the fearful thunderings and lightnings which accompanied this visitation of God, so impressed the minds of the people with fear and reverence to his sacred majesty that they instinctively drew back from the awful presence of God, lest they should not be able to endure his terrible glory. Get that. It says they instinctively drew back. That's what God's presence does to humanity, friends. is so majestic, so wonderful, so grand. In Psalms 89, in verse 7, it says, God is greatly to be feared in the assembly of the saints and to be had in reverence of all them that are about him. Now, I know many times we read this word fear in the Bible and we're very quick to say, well, you know, that means reverence, right? But friends, it doesn't always mean just simply reverence. It means to have a holy fear. It means to have a holy fear. Because here it's linked with reverence, something separate from just reverence. You are afraid to hurt his character. You are afraid to speak ill against him or to live in a way that violates him. In our next slide, the Hebrew word is aratz, and it means to cause to tremble, to stand in awe. The Theological Word Book of the New Testament, commenting upon this word, says also in volume 2, page 699, Yahweh is to be held in reverential awe, fearing him, one needs fear no other. Isn't that nice? In other words, if we can fear God, we don't need to fear anyone else. It is said that John the Baptist could stand erect in front of kings and nobles because he had bowed low before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I believe, friends, that we should have respect also for God's Word, the Bible. Respect for the Bible. Deuteronomy chapter 4. And how do we have respect for the Bible? There's a lot of ways, but I want to point out one specific way. Deuteronomy chapter 4. Because, friends, you can't separate God from His Word. Deuteronomy chapter 4 and verse 2. Notice what it says here. You shall not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall you diminish aught from it, that ye may keep the commandments of the Lord your God which I command you. Now notice it says that we're not to do this for a reason, and that reason is that if we diminish His word, if we add to, we take away, we're not going to be able to keep His commandments properly, friends, because the Bible, His word, gives us instruction on how to keep His commandments. And it's perfect already. We don't need to add to it. If I have something that's already in a perfect state, friends, I don't need to take away from it. And I don't need to add to it because if I do, I mar its perfection. It's like if I have a blueprint. You know, there are some things that we can change about a blueprint as we're building sometimes. We can maybe make a little alteration here, a little alteration there. But if I start changing the foundation, if I start making big changes, then everything is not going to fit anymore. Amen. You know? And that's just a house. But we're thinking here, friends, about the character of God. And the character of God, it can't be fixed by changing anything that is a revelation of Him. His revelation is perfect already. We don't need to change it. Amen. In Proverbs chapter 30, verses 5 and 6, every word of God is what? It's pure. Every word of God is pure. He is a shield unto them that put their trust in Him. Add thou not unto His word, lest He reprove thee, and thou be found a liar. You see, friends, God's word is true. But anytime we try to add to it, take away from it, change it, we're simply a liar. Because we're changing what is truth. And so one of the ways we respect God's word is that we don't add to it. We understand and we acknowledge its purity. And we should reverence it. And I know that the Bible I have here, while it may seem to be simply made of paper and leather and stitching, this represents God's Word, and I should treat this book with respect. I should treat this book with dignity, because it's God's Word to me. And I'm not to just throw it around. I'm not just to casually treat it like I would other books. We have a special revelation given to us in Revelation 22. Revelation chapter 22, the last chapter of the Bible, in verses 18 and 19. John says, For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book. If any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written in this book. There are some pretty good things written in this book in Revelation chapter 21, 22 especially, for the righteous. And God says, I'll take that away. And God is not arbitrary. God is not capricious. God is not saying, I'm going to do this just simply because I want to show you I'm boss. But God knows, friends, that when we change His Word, that we cannot form a character that will be fit for heaven. Because it's only His Word that teaches us and guides us into a character perfection, a character that's fit for heaven. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 9, He said, "For in vain do they worship Me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men." Friends, when we change God's Word, our worship becomes vain. We fail to show God respect. And you know, we talked a minute earlier when we started about a sanctuary, or the place that we worship God. And I believe that there is supposed to be special respect shown to holy places set aside for the worship of God. And there was something also very special we'll talk about in a minute that was within the sanctuary that was very holy. But let's turn to Leviticus chapter 19, verse 30 first. It says, "You shall keep My Sabbaths and reverence My sanctuary. I am the Lord." He says that we were to reverence His sanctuary. The Lord, He says, is in His holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before Him. Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 20. There's something about the sanctuary of God, friends, His temple, where we are to show special reverence. And the main reason is because, friends, He is here. He comes to meet with us in this place. You know, Jesus, He had a zeal. He had a zeal even for the earthly tabernacle, that temple that had been made with hands. In John chapter 2, verses 13 through 17, it says, "And the Jews' Passover was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem, and found in the temple those that sold oxen and sheep and doves and the changers of money sitting. And when He had made a scourge of small cords, He drove them out of the temple and the sheep and the oxen, and poured out the changers' money and overthrew the tables." Boy, I tell you, he sounded like a rebel and a vigilante, didn't he? This was a man of action. "And He said unto them that sold doves, Take these things hence. Make not My Father's house an house of merchandise. And His disciples remembered that it was written, The zeal of thine house hath eaten Me up." And that was a quotation from Psalm 69, I believe, verse 9. It says, the zeal of thy house hath eaten Me up. In other words, it has consumed Me. And so He was interested in the sanctuary. But within the sanctuary, within the temple, actually it wasn't in the temple at that time, but before this, there had been something in the most holy place. And what was that article of furniture in the most holy place? It was the Ark of the Covenant. And it was considered sacred. And the children of Israel believed that it carried the presence and the power of God. And they believed that so much so that sometimes when they went out to battle, they took the Ark out into battle with them, believing that it had some kind of a power about it that would give them victory. But one time they took it out when they shouldn't have taken it out, and the Philistines captured the Ark. And do you remember what happened when some of the Philistines ventured to look upon the sacred Ark of God? Let's turn to 1 Samuel chapter 6 and let's read it. 1 Samuel chapter 6, verses 19 and 20. "And He," that is God, "smote the men of Beth-Shemeth, because they had looked unto the ark of the Lord. Even He smote of the people 50,000 and 70 men, and the people lamented, because the Lord had smitten many of the people with a great slaughter. And the men of Beth-Shemeth said, Who is able to stand before this holy Lord God, and to whom shall He go up for us?" And so, friends, just to look upon that ark was the look of death. There was a man whose name was Uzzah. And he reached out to study the ark one time. David was moving the ark. And instead of carrying it upon the shoulders of the Levites as they were supposed to, they made a new cart. You know, it had become modern. And they were moving it, and it must have hit a rut or a place in the pathway, and it began to shake, and Uzzah was afraid it was going to move or fall off. And he put forth his hand to touch it. And that touch was the touch of death. You can read about it in 1 Samuel chapter 6, verses 1 through 7. But in Testimonies for the Church, volume 8, page 284, "Again consider the judgment that fell upon Uzzah. As in David's reign, the ark was being carried to Jerusalem. Uzzah put forth his hand to keep it steady. For presuming to touch the symbol of God's presence, he was smitten with instant death. So do you think, friends, that the symbol of God's presence was a light thing? Or is it a pretty heavy thing? It was a pretty important thing, wasn't it? And when we come before the presence of God, friends, in His sanctuary, we should come with a holy awe. I believe that part of honoring the character of God, friends, also involves respecting His chosen servants. If we could turn to 1 Samuel chapter 8, we're close there. The children of Israel, they decided they wanted to have a king and be like the nations around them. Samuel knew this was a bad plan. He felt bad about it. But God told Samuel something here. In 1 Samuel chapter 8 and verse 7, "And the Lord said unto Samuel, Hearken unto the voice of the people and all that they say unto thee, for they have not rejected thee, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them." There's a principle here, friends. When we reject the servants of God, it's not really the servants of God we're rejecting, it's God. But the same is also true going in the other direction. And when we learn to show respect to the servants of God, we are showing respect to God. And that is important. Let's notice a few texts in the New Testament. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 12 and 13. He says, "And we beseech you, brethren, to know them which labor among you and are over you in the Lord and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake, and be at peace among yourselves." And what does the word esteem mean? What does the word esteem mean? To show and to give, to have in high regard, to show respect, to show dignity, to have appreciation for. In 1 Timothy chapter 5, in verse 17, he says, "Let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor." Let the elders that rule well. And another translation says something like this, "To esteem the elders who help direct the affairs of the church." That's what we should do. The elders who are helping to direct the affairs of the church, we should esteem them. But he goes on to say, in the next part of the verse, he says, "Let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in word and doctrine." So you've got men who are preaching, and they're preaching the word, and they're preaching doctrine. And that's Brother Fred Scusi there. We hope to have Fred at the camp meeting this year. When they're preaching that word of doctrine, friends, we should doubly esteem these kind of men and show them respect and honor. That's what God's word says. So I ask now, what is the purpose of all this respect? I mean, really, what does it come down to? And I think we mentioned it earlier, but let's recap it. Respect for God. Respect for His name. Respect for His word. Respect for His sanctuary. Respect for all that is involved. It leads to godly living. And that's what God wants from us most of all. It leads to godly living. In Exodus chapter 20, if we could go back there and just reread a verse again. Exodus chapter 20 and verse 20. "And Moses said unto the people, Fear not, for God has come to prove you, and that His fear may be before your faces, that means because of something, that ye sin not." Does God want you to sin? "Little children, these things I write unto you, that ye sin not." 1 John 2:1. He doesn't want us to sin. And He says that these things I've come to prove you so that you do not sin. I've come to give you my very presence so that you do not sin. He says, it's interesting in this verse, because if you look at the beginning of it, Moses said to the people, what's the first two words? Amen. Fear not. But then he says that His fear may be before you. Fear not, but that His fear may be before you. God says there's a place for a holy, awesome fear. We are to walk in His ways. In 2 Chronicles chapter 6, in verses 30 and 31. "Then hear thou from heaven thy dwelling place, and forgive and render unto every man according unto all his ways, whose heart thou knowest, for thou only knowest the hearts of the children of men." Of course, this is Solomon's prayer, his dedication prayer. "That they may fear thee to walk in thy ways, so long as they live in the land which thou gavest unto our fathers." He says that they might fear you so that they will walk in your ways. I want to be very honest with you. I never ever walked out of my dad's ways when I was ever in his sight. Now, I did a lot of things when I was out of his sight, I'll admit that. But when I was living in His presence, His rules were law, and they were never disobeyed. And sometimes that was done out of fear, it's true. And God has the highest motive of love. He ultimately wants us to serve Him from. But you know, friends, whenever we're tempted to do wrong, if we would just remember the presence of God and the presence of His angels, it would do wonders to be a blessing to us. In Proverbs chapter 16 and verse 6, it says, "By mercy and truth iniquity is purged, and by the fear of the Lord men depart from evil." By the fear of the Lord men depart from evil. And I thought, friends, about Lucifer for a minute. Something happened in Lucifer that he had lost his fear. He had lost his reverence of God. And he sinned. And we can't explain why that happened. But somehow he lost that reverence for God. And he didn't fear God anymore. And he looked upon God as someone more like an equal than his Creator. Someone who he could challenge. Someone who he could outwit. Maybe even overpower. What about us? Do we sometimes feel that way? Do we get this big head that we're pretty big and pretty good? But if we would remember the fear of the Lord, friends, we would depart from evil. And this brings action into our lives. Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 7. Hebrews 11, 7 says, "By faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with," what's the next word? Fear. "He moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith." I want to tell you, I'm glad that Noah was afraid. I'm glad that he feared the God of heaven. Because if he hadn't have, the ark wouldn't have got built. And everything would have been lost. We need to be moved into action. And may I remind you, as we're told in the book Upward Look on page 89, that repeated actions form habits, and habits form character. That's what we're out for here, is character, friends. And character doesn't come without actions, repeated actions. And those are actions of obedience. And friends, we are to honor God. We are to honor His name. And that can come in different ways. In the Sabbath school, one of the Sabbath schools here, they were talking about characteristics of God. And we think of the character of God, and our mind sometimes harps back to Exodus 34, and He's merciful, loving, you know, all those things, and He is. But I'm listening right now, and you listen. And our microphone might not be picking it up for the broadcast and the recording, but there are birds singing outside right now. And they're singing a beautiful song. You know why? Because God is musical. God is musical. And God is artistic. You know, I'm glad that we don't live in a Tri-X world. Mike knows what that means. Tri-X was a Kodak film that was made for many, many years. It was a black and white film. It became the stay of the journalism industry, photojournalism industry, Tri-X. Everybody used Tri-X. 400-speed film. Could be pushed to 16, even 3200-speed when necessary. And for low-light situations. But God didn't make a black and white world. You know. I mean, we're out here in the vividness of Kodachrome, high definition. You know, 256, 32 million colors counting. That's the kind of God we have, an artistic God. You know, He didn't have to make everything like He did. He didn't have to make all the flowers and their different arrangements, but He's artistic. Now, not everyone carries the same musical abilities, the same artistic abilities, or talents. Not everyone is a preacher. Not everyone's cut out to be, you know, an evangelist. And God didn't call everyone to be an apostle. But whatever God has called you to do, whatever talents He has given you, then you are to use them to honor and to glorify His name and His character in your life. And above all, through obedience to His law. Obedience to the gifts that He has given you, but obedience to His Ten Commandment holy law. You can bring honor and glory to God. You can bring honor to His holy name. And you can worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. May God bless you lots and lots and lots.